Throughout the history of man, there is one common problem plaguing each and every race: natural-born losers. In each culture, they are the same, roaming predators engorging themselves on life's excesses without regard for tomorrow. They hustle and con their fellow man to support the most worthless and perverted pleasures. To better understand this depraved being, we must first be able to spot and identify the different categories of losers, such as your typical deadbeat or general filth and scum. But first, we shall focus on the most dreadful loser of them all.
Everybody to Acid Eaters Month, where I take a look at some of the most psychedelic animated movies ever created. Oh, how I've waited for this day to finally arrive. There's nothing more hardcore than watching a crazy, trippy movie while having a crazy acid trip. For the next month, I'm going to be looking at four different animated movies and shows featuring some of the most bizarre images, colors, shapes, and all kinds of supernatural things thrown at the screen, like you just took bad medicine. And trust me, bad medicine is what you'll need. It was around the time of the 60s when drugs, sex, and rock and roll were taking over. The British invasion had hit with bands like The Beatles, The Who, and Rolling Stones coming to liven up the decade. Animation was also on the rise, with comic book and manga characters now getting their own spots on television, like Batman, Spider-Man, Captain America, and the Hulk. While they may seem tame compared to the violent nature in today's cartoons, I wouldn't take them too lightly, oh no, because more often than not, the psychedelic power of the 60s would overcome a cartoon and fill it with unexplained imagery and imagination. Take, for example, the Spider-Man episode Revolt in the Fifth Dimension. It's like going through a freaking nightmare, with Spider-Man venturing into Dementia 5 and facing off against stock footage from Rocket Robin Hood, as well as putting up with tentacle rape and even death. Trust me, if you were disgusted by Spider-Man one more day, then you'll most likely be revolted by Revolt in the Fifth Dimension. But I digress. Today, I'm not going to be reviewing something from the 60s per se, but more of a tribute to the 60s. In this case, when DC's teenage superheroes, the Teen Titans, made their television debut in 2003, the creators decided to throw them into a world reminiscent to the 60s, from the weird effects to even making the villain a rebellious British mod. Enter Mad Mod, a limey clothes designer who was first introduced in Teen Titans Issue 7 way back in 1967. He was one of the very first villains introduced to the comics, and his specialty was pulling random traps and pranks on the team. Think of him almost as the Titans' version of the Joker, except British and gay. So get your LSD ready and let the ecstasy roll through your system as we watch the Teen Titans episode Mad Mod. Roll the footage! We open up with Robin and the rest of the Titans, all strapped up to chairs in the middle of what looks like the chessboard from Harry Potter.
Am I the only one who has no idea where we are?
Why, you're right where you belong, my duckies. You're in school. That's right, lads and lovies. You're the only students at Mad Mod's Institute for Bratty Teenage Do-Gooders.
Wait a minute. Haven't I heard that voice before? That bizarre, intimidating, overly exaggerated British accent?
Ah, and it's high time someone taught you Sproggs a lesson.
Sproggs? Wait a minute. Hang on just a second. What the... By Ludwig von Beethoven! The villain is voiced by Malcolm McDowell! So yes, Caligula himself plays our villain, Mad Mod, who kidnapped all the Titans and brought them back to a school of stereotypical Britishness.
I didn't go to all the trouble of building this school and filling your tower with knockout gas just to finish you off lickety-split.
Then what do you want?
Just what I said, dearie. To teach you lot a lesson.
Interesting how just this one guy was able to break into Titan's Tower, get past all the security, and kidnap all five heroes, including a 616-pound cyborg, and be able to bring them all back to his lair without even breaking a sweat. I admire realism in these cartoons.
Yes, I've been watching you children misbehave, and I hate misbehaving children. Fighting crime, saving lives, interfering with the plans of hard-working villains.
And let's not forget those nude photographs of yourself on the internet. You lot should be ashamed of yourselves!
We will get out, and when we do...
But uh-oh, there's the bell. That means class has started for the Titans, as they're sent through trapdoors to their first lesson. So, what are the Titans going to learn today?
Will it be how crime fighting is not the solution to your problems? Or how to properly speak the Queen's English? Or why little kids should learn manners and not talk back.
You have no reason to hate VR Gamer.
Now how can I teach you anything if you won't sit still and listen?
Instead, Madmon fills up the entire room with hypno discs. Wait a minute. Hypno discs? So now the Titans have been captured by Alex from Clockwork Orange, who uses hypno-discs as weapons. Yeah, they're fucked. But Robin, being that he wears a mask over his young blood-diseased eyes, is able to free himself from the chair and silence the discs. But now Robin has to deal with Madmon statue, shooting lasers and a giant bomb.
4, 3, 2, 1.
Bombs in a school? Columbine much?
There goes my shot at perfect attendance.
Don't be so sure, my little ducky. You may be out of the classroom, but class is never dismissed. Next lesson? Physics! What goes up, stays up!
Jeez, what school does all this take place anyway? Swansea?
No, actually it's the M.C. Escher University, where they teach how to make ordinary design patterns look like awesome backgrounds, and how escalators can extend into infinitely long escalators.
Welcome to the House of Fun!
Welcome to the House of Fun, now I've come of age. Welcome to the House of Fun!
We then cut to Starfire, strapped up to her chair, being given the Ludovico treatment. No, I shit you not. They're doing the same thing they did to McDowell in A Clockwork Orange. So basically what this episode is trying to do is be like a parody of A Clockwork Orange by having Malcolm McDowell play the villainous, devious lad, with all the other characters being incarcerated and being forced to go through many horrible tortures in order to improve their well-being.
In fact, all that's really missing from this episode to make it a legitimate sequel is all the gratuitous sex, violence, and music by Ludwig von Beethoven. Don't correct me, I know it's Ludwig von Beethoven.
So Robin finds Starfire and gets her out just before she gets crushed by a stamp. They make their way past more bizarre traps before finally ending up in a laboratory where they find Beast Boy.
Oh yeah, a model student, that one. Lovely. Sits there, quietly. Never thinks about misbehaving. Matter of fact, he never thinks at all.
Oh, poor Beast Boy. You really should have laid off those blunts. Remember what happened to him at the end of Simon Says? Exactly.
Suddenly, the laboratory starts exploding, and slime left over from the Kids' Choice Award starts filling up the room, but the trio manages to get out of there before it fills up. As for Beast Boy, well, the little green guy is still out like a light.
Starfire, your friend! Please, speak to me! Beast Boy! Beast Boy!
You are tearing me apart, Beast Boy!
So Cyborg and Raven finally show up, and Beast Boy finally regains consciousness. Now it's time for the team to face off against Madmon and his array of more hypno-discs, traps, cannons, and British pop references.
This looks like a job for Poker Power!
I want what I really, really want.
So tell us what you want, what you really, really want.
I'll tell you what I want, what I really, really want.
So tell us what you want, what you really, really want.
I want a I wanna really wanna zig a zig ah.
If you wanna be my lover, you gotta get with my friends. Make it last forever, friendship never ends. If you wanna be my lover, you have got to give. Taking is too easy, but that's the way it is.
Jesus!
After a short fight scene with the laser shooting statues, the team finally catches up to Mad Mod, only to find out that he's actually a hologram, and that the real Mad Mod is some craggy old dude operating all the traps in the school.
Well, that explains all the teleporting and all the crazy trippy effects, but it doesn't really explain how a projected image was able to use that cane to shock the Titans while they were in their chairs.
Unless, of course, the holograms had the holovirus.
Mr. Flibble says, game over, boys.
So Robin sneaks into a ventilation shaft and breaks all the wires so that Madmont's machine no longer works.
Hello, Governor.
School's out, Mod. And you're looking at about 20 years of detention.
It's the trophy for you, matey! So the Titans finally make their way out of the lair and into sunlight. But wait! What about Beast Boy?
I cannot awaken Beast Boy! I have tried the tickling, all manner of bodily noises, and the word underpants. I fear that this time his brain is gone forever!
Oh, but have you ever thought of giving him the kiss of life? That could revive him. Raven, would you like to do the honors?
Beast Boy had a brain.
Good one!
That works too.
And so the episode ends with the Titans tying up Mad Mod and taking him away to jail for kidnapping. We then get a wide-out shot showing that the entire episode actually took place on an oil rig. Wait a minute, an oil rig?
British Petroleum, you sick bastards. You pollute our waters and kidnap our childhood heroes! You are fucking evil, you know that? Pure evil! And hey, you know that $25 gas card I got from you guys? Your $4 a gallon makes it completely useless. Huh? So there. Hey, you know, I just thought of something. British people are evil. Yeah, you know.
Evil, 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 evil! The British invasion, the War of Independence, Ricky Gervais' Oscar speech...
It's official! British people are evil! I said, British people are evil! Damn it, where the heck is he? And oh, dearest Hagen, as I lay my hand softly upon your makeup-covered face, I look into your eyes and I... Hey, nasty pants! Gah! Blimey! Can't you learn to stay out of one's privacy? I'll think about that next time I'm not completely grossed out. Right. But what's this I'm hearing, kid? You're saying that British people are evil? When have we ever been evil? Well, you and Hagen did kidnap me last year and forced me to watch Fritz the Cat as part of your big plot to take over the world. By the way, whatever happened with that? Yeah, well, I did succeed in making myself ruler of the world, but then it got boring. So instead, I decided to take over Tetley. Now I can get to all the free tea I want! Yeah, good for you. I still hate you, though. Eh, why, kid? Are you still buggered that D-12 lost that robot fight to Hypnodisc? He's sleeping. Bother. Now if you excuse me, I have to finish writing my love letter to my dearest Diamanda. Oh, yeah, BG, about that. Diamanda is dead. What?
You know. No! Yeah, so, whatever. So what did I think of this episode?
To put it simply, it's surreal. With its crazy shapes, random traps, and pop culture references, it is one wacky episode that I'm sure the animators had a lot of fun with. However, being that it's one of the first episodes produced, it's obvious that the show still needed some polishing before really going mainstream. The animation can be jumpy, and the voice acting is also pretty stiff. Malcolm McDowell does put up a good performance as Mad Mod, but he's nowhere near as memorable as other actors as villains like Ron Perlman as Slade or Kevin Michael Richardson as Trigon.
But again, with the problems I mentioned, it's still a filler episode, and with the lack of fighting and constant images of Beast Boy drooling, it's really just a turnoff for me. So as much as I love the show, I have to give this episode a hardcore headache. So a bit of a rocky start to Acid Eaters Month, but don't worry, there's still much more to go. And I guarantee you're going to be seeing a lot more trippy stuff than just hypno discs.
Fail!